sweet dreams till sunbeams find you. Sweet dreams that leave all worries behind you. But in your dreams, whatever they be, dream a little dream of me.
Good morning. You're listening to KSQD Santa Cruz, K-Squid 90.7 FM, and streaming live at ksqd.org. I am Catherine Bell, and this is The Dream Journal, a weekly show where we explore the healing powers of your nighttime dreams through conversations with dream experts and with you. In the words of Carl Jung, who looks outside dreams, who looks inside awakens. Have you ever had a difficult relationship in your life? Aha, who of us has not? Our guest today will talk about how dream work can make your challenging relationships a little bit easier. This is Catherine Bell of Experiential Dream Work, and welcome to the Dream Journal. I'd like to remind you that the views and opinions expressed in this program do not necessarily represent those of Natural Bridges Media or of KSQD's staff, volunteers, or underwriters. The Dream Journal is also a podcast, which is great in case you miss part of the show or if you'd like to binge listen to get your dream on. Look for it, review it, subscribe, and tell a friend. It really does help people find the show. So I'd like to start with my personal dream work. What's happening for me right now? There's a dream in which I'm chasing after these elves, these kind of like short, waist-high people with pointy ears. And there's something like I'm chasing after them, and I'd like to be with them, or maybe I'd like to kind of be one of them. So what are elves to me? Elves are mischievous. They kind of can be kind of sharp sometimes. Sometimes they're a little bit mean, but they like make fun of people. You know, there's a way that I've been told that I should never make a joke. I actually literally had somebody tell me that once, that my sarcasm in particular never comes off as anything other than mean. So that kind of stung. It stayed with me all these years. Can't even remember who it was who said that to me, but the word stayed. But maybe there's some way that I get to reclaim some of my mischievousness. Is there some way that it's okay for me to be playful again? You know, maybe I could be... There's something about the mystery of elves, too, that they're magical creatures, and there's something about that. A lot of creatures showing up in my dreams lately that are not quite human. Sometimes they're elves like these, and sometimes it's non-identifiable. Like there's these nuns that have heads that are like lumps. They're not, they have faces, but their heads are like pink blobs. Another one I had was a singer who had black sinuous tentacles. Her whole body was sinuous. So is there something transmogrifying? I don't even know if that's a word. Is there something transforming in me about my relationship to my body? Maybe it doesn't have to be as rigid as I think. So these are just things that I'm mulling over and wondering what's going to come next in the dreams. Like I do every week, I will be inviting call-ins during the last 20 minutes of the show. You can get your questions ready and jot down the number now. It's 831-900-5773. I'd love to hear about one of your dreams, or you could ask a question. So that number again for later in the show is 831-900-5773. Amy Trafford is an archetypal dream therapist. She graduated from Goddard College and did her postgraduate studies at the Center for Archetypal Dreamwork, where she learned to work with people and their dreams in small groups, large groups, and one-on-one. She has a weekly podcast, Raising a Lion in the Jungle, and Co-Parenting and Dreams with Benjamin Newman. Hi, Amy.
Hi, Catherine.
Wonderful. So welcome to the Dream Journal, Amy. How are you doing this morning?
Thank you. Thanks, Catherine. It's the afternoon here in Vermont. It's hot, and I'm feeling very tender, very, very tender. Because you guys don't know me, that's a good thing. For me, anything that I'm feeling is a good thing.
Yeah.
Even if I say I'm full of terror or I'm in agonizing pain, it's really good. And I had a dream last night about this.
Oh, tell me.
So I know it's so great. I woke after the dream and I was like, you guys, feeling the archetypes, just so grateful and clear. This is what I start with, is this dream that I had, which relates to my work completely, my own current work with my dreams and my spiritual path. In the dream, I'll just speak about the tenderness for a moment.
Sure.
The dreams brought up a feeling that I have never felt before.
Mm.
I can say sad, a sadness, but it had a specific quality to it. And I really have nothing to compare it to. I can feel it now. I can feel the heat and myself tears coming, I don't really know. I can't say more about it. Mm. To you, I can't explain it to anyone, except to say that this feeling was open, this particular kind of sadness and pain with this certain quality. And I don't know about it because it's brand new. That's what, in the end of the dream, that's what was opened. That was the gift for me.
Mm.
That was sort of the dream is the treasure chest. And, when I opened it, that was the gleaming gem within, was this feeling of this particular feeling of sadness, of pain.
Yeah, there's such a rich variety of experiences that we can feel in our bodies, and so often we're limited to the five, glad, sad, mad, the basic five feelings, and yet there's so much more nuance and depth that we open up to our sensual bodies that are available to us, and we just don't even have language for a lot of this.
Right, and I agree so much. And I remember when I first started working with my dreams, when I was, for over half my life now, I've been working with my dreams. And when I first started, my palette was limited.
Mm.
And now, once I stopped trying to figure things out, and once I stopped that great impulse out of, I think, that comes from fear and the ego, where needing to understand what it is, to be able to name it specifically. Once I learned to just steep in the feeling and just allow it to open and open in me without trying to figure it out, really, everything started to change for me.
Right. Tell me about that. What was it like before, and what drew you toward dream work originally?
Before, I was pretty shut down.
Mm.
I think I was pretty much, looking back now, I can say I was in trauma or trauma reaction, for most, for the time. Since probably I was 13, that was when things were really acute. I started to become very depressed and actively trying to hurt myself, just a lot of nihilism and anorexia, mm-hmm. Cutting, you know, like just really, mm-hmm. this, it might sound cold to say, it's kind of typical.
Mm-hmm.
Now, unfortunately, I mm-hmm. feel like that, mm-hmm. but at the same time that was all happening, my dreams were really, really blossoming.
Mm.
Something was really happening. The volume got turned up when I was like starting at about 12. And so my dreams were like this lifeline. Mm. I would go to sleep and I would dream, not understanding what was happening, but I would have a dream and wake up and go to the, you know, get ready for school, mm. go to the bus stop, get on the bus. And I sat next to a dear, dear friend of mine, and we would talk about our dreams
mm.
on the way to school.
Mm-hmm.
And
so wonderful that you had that refuge.
Really, it really was.
Yeah.
You know, there's no mistake.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's really no mistake. It really was such a godsend and like a grounding place for me.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm still grateful for her, you know, Jennifer, for her to have that ritual with me. Because it gave me what I needed to just get through the day at school. So as that was happening more and more, everything was opening for me in the dream world, like in the sort of now I know it was the archetypal realm. I was having these experiences with my dreams. It was like my dreams could tell that I was paying attention. And they started to speak to me, kind of, to really, there was something really happening
mm.
there in the midst. And then in my waking life, I had a lot of self-hate. I was crippled by shame. I was, you know, bullied in school. I was having a really hard time.
Mm.
So my outer life, as they say, you know, my waking life did not match what was happening inside.
Right.
And that later on would cause another kind of pain for me. But so that was the beginning of things for me, was always feeling this connection with my dreams and not thinking much of it. But this relationship began when I was about 12 and never really stopped.
Mm-hmm.
Through everything, through my kind of nihilistic self-sabotage, you know, dramatic ways of like hurting myself and trying to understand what was going on and process things. And I did have, as you said, this refuge.
Mm-hmm.
And then when I got to college, I had some tools to really kind of manage my nihilism. My eating disorder was less active, though it was still there, you know. And I kind of was like, I can get by.
Mm.
I can probably live. Like, this isn't so bad. Like, I don't constantly want to kill myself. Mm. I don't think about it all the time. But I just felt something screaming inside me,
mm-hmm.
and that was like, if I'm going to live, I really want to live.
Mm, yeah.
I don't want it to be
mm-hmm.
like this.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I just knew that there was more, and this is coming from this relationship that I had been developing with this whole world of my dreams. And a dear friend of mine started seeing an archetypal dream therapist who was in the area, and they said, she knows me very, very well, and we have similar issues. And she said, you know, I started doing this, and I just thought of you.
Mm-hmm.
And she just handed me the phone number, and that was it.
Yeah.
And that was it. You know, I walked in to the first session, and I didn't know what was happening. I was like, this person is speaking my language for the first time in my life.
Wow.
You know,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I can't even tell you anything more about my early sessions. you know, like specifics of dreams or anything, except the feeling of being there and just submerging and opening up and allowing, like sort of coming out with my connection that I had with my dreams and having a safe space to be in that world with someone else just changed everything for me.
Right.
You know?
Wow, that's so beautiful. That's so beautiful, Amy. I mean, just to find someone who knows how to speak your language and that's on the same page for you, what an amazing opportunity. And I want to talk a lot more about archetypal dream work, and what that means. But we need to take a short break here, and we will come right back. In about 20 minutes, I'll be opening the phones so that you can call in to 831-900-5773. You can share a dream you're curious about or ask us a question. So that's in about 15-20 minutes, 831-900-5773. We are here with Amy Trafford. This is the Dream Journal on KSQD 90.7 FM, and I am your host, Catherine Bell.
I made moonshine, now I'm a fire-breathing heathen in the night. I'm all tangled in the tail of a runaway kite. Oh, where am I? Moonshine. Can you tune up the inner workings of the years? Can you burn off the dust, loosen up the gears of my heart?
I'd like to cordially invite listeners to join me for another round of my Experiencing Your Dreams workshops. This month, we will talk about the four elements in dreams: earth, air, fire, and water. Think about caves and mountains, tornadoes, volcanoes, and rivers and oceans. What could it mean when these common dream elements appear for you? Workshops are on Zoom and are highly interactive. We start Monday, August 3rd. Contact me to register or register through my website at experientialdreamwork.com/workshops. Plus, there is room for one or two more dreamers in my latest online interactive working dream group. Want to go deep into your own personal dreams in the safe container of like-minded souls? Contact me to inquire about either of these offerings at Catherine@ksqd.org. That's Katherine@ksqd.org. This is the Dream Journal. My name is Catherine Bell, and we are here live with Amy Trafford. Hello.
Hi.
Yeah, I love that you shared that with me, that tender journey that you have of discovery, of really finding someone, some place that speaks your language, the language of dreams. And you've a couple times used the phrase archetypal dream work, and I wonder if you could say more about that and what that is.
Yeah, thank you. So the kind of work that I do with people, how I would describe it, you know, I was trained in Vermont for many, many years, and archetypal dream work is really about, to me, it's sort of loosely based on Jungian, like the Red Book, Jung, if anyone knows of the Red Book. And really it's about the immersion, you know, the immersion into the dream, stepping into the dreams with another and exploring, as I was speaking of, you know, that whole realm. So walking in with someone into that world with them and supporting them to explore and feel the feelings that the dreams bring, that the dreams are really asking us to feel. Mm. And that is the opportunity, you know, and the opportunity for healing is less about the story of the dream and way more about the feelings that the dreams awaken, and often just, you know, one particular feeling, and how that can lead us, you know, like breadcrumbs down the path to our souls, you know. And just reawakening, you know, reawakening to that great spark of joy and life, you know, the child within us.
Mm-hmm. Well, like you were saying in your personal journey, maybe it's so much more than, well, I could survive here. Like, how can I actually have a rich and full life instead of just getting by, surviving on that river of misery that so many of us, and I myself included, settled for a long time. But we know there's more. And the dreams, as you say, I also trained in archetypal dream work, offer the breadcrumbs that bring us back to a richer, fuller experience of life and really our souls.
Yeah, and just, you know, for me, what part of it is sort of going through the motions,
mm-hmm.
you know, and that was the question, was like, I just am not a going through the motions, you know, person. And yet that was where I was at, you know, and I think that's just very commonly what happens in the world for us all is that we get, once we become adults, you know, and we have responsibility, and so we need to do things, like we need to have a job and pay rent and pay our bills and eat food and have shelter,
yep.
if we choose those things, which, so, you know, there are responsibilities that we have, and then it just becomes, you know, I really became, and my dreams helped me see this, and this is a thing, this is one of the great gifts that I'm just, dreams never cease to completely blow me away, ever. You know, and they always surprise me. And I, you know, it is by far my favorite thing. You know, and that is just so we can see, like, we don't know that we're just going through the motions. We don't know that we forget. We have forgotten who we are.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so we're doing the things on our list, and we have our calendar, and we're going to work, and for some of us, it's like Monday through Friday, and oh, now the weekend, and all that stuff. And now, within this pandemic, we get into a different routine. You know, there's a different routine, and now some of us, you know, I know this for myself. I was like, wow, I'm really in this new routine of the pandemic.
Mm-hmm.
And it's for me, it was my dreams that really woke me up, and that's what dreams are trying to do, is really wake us up to something. And it's different for all of us, you know, but part of the waking is like, hey, I'm kind of walking around like not really feeling anything, you know, kind of numb and
mm-hmm.
just, right. you know, bleh.
Right.
So,
and, you know, and I've my experience is that I thought I was feeling stuff. I was getting frustrated and angry, or I would be like having a good day, which was like kind of like neutral. But there's just so much more that's available in the, you know.
Right. And exactly, like the projection and reaction, you know, it's kind of, I didn't even know what those words meant. It took me 10 years to understand what projection was. I was just, that was the way of life.
Mm.
You know, it was like all of my relationships were really just projections. And so I didn't know any different. It's like I think it's hard to get. You know, you can read a definition or something, but to really understand and feel it in your body, you know, and that is the thing about the sensuality and again, the gift of the dreams, is that with those feelings, people say to me, my dream, I had this dream, and like, it was so real, Amy.
Mm.
And I'm like, that's because it is real. And they're like, no, you don't understand. It was so real. I'm like, okay, like, yes, it is real. Exactly. And that realness, that shows the discrepancy, because that is real.
Mm.
And in our waking life, you know, it serves as such a contrast to how we feel in our waking life. And that's a good wake up. That's something to really notice, you know, because that feeling that the dreams awakened is like possible everywhere, you know, that level of aliveness. But to say yes to that level of aliveness, you have to say yes to everything, to the pain, to the fear, to the joy, to, you know, to the sorrow, to all those colors, to all the feelings that have no name.
Mm-hmm. Right. And the dreams really bring us images that are so helpful with those feelings that have no name, because they bring us images. And so they may not be a name for exactly what I'm feeling, but maybe the feeling is I'm chasing after elves. You know, they're like, that is,
yeah,
it kind of anchors me in the image, and then that's what it feels like.
Absolutely. When you said that, I got the chill. My whole body got the chills, Catherine. You know, just, yeah, absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. I felt like I was running there with you. You know, it's like, that is it right there. And it's so beautiful, because what a great example of just be with the elf.
Right.
That's it.
Right.
You know, don't even think, you don't think about it. Don't have, it needs to be no story. You know, our mind just wants to make up stories, and that's okay. But it's like our dreams help, you know, and that's part of the medicine for me, is once I stopped that cycle of the ego trying to really explain things and the need to understand, everything in life was so much more pleasurable.
Mm-hmm.
You know, just like I'm just in the feeling. I'm in the moment.
Right.
I'm just in it. I'm not outside of it trying to describe it and trying to understand it. I'm just here,
right,
running with the elves. It, you know.
So
in my case, it's a white snake man. You know, I had a dream of this wild white snake.
Ooh.
You know, man who was a white snake and was just in this creative explosion, and you know, just being in the energy of that. Mm. And I can feel it now as I'm talking.
Right.
To
right. Well, you know, that's one of the ways that I find really valuable to work with dreams, and I know you do too, that is what we call it, homework, but it always sounds a little bit like school again. But you know, to take these images and these feelings that come up in our dreams and really practice them and like actually bring them into our every waking life moment, and as often as we think of it, 5 times a day to 5 times an hour, and go, oh yeah, white snake man or chasing the elves, and like kind of like let yourself feel if you're anywhere near that feeling, or just remember the feeling and bring the image up, and to kind of exercise that muscle of feeling so that we get to broaden our repertoire of feelings.
Absolutely, yeah. And so it becomes, this is the other thing, the great paradox of dreams, and in the way that I, you know, that I have been trained and I have worked, and my therapist has worked with me, you know, in this way where it becomes, it's incredibly esoteric and yet also incredibly practical,
yeah,
at the same time,
mm-hmm,
which can feel kind of crazy, but in a great way. You know, it's like, because when we bring it, you know, I'll say to people I work with, be in the line at the grocery store. And as soon as you start to feel, you know, that irritation, you feel reactive, you're feeling, you know, that like you're judging, and you're whatever the dream will bring. This is an example of what dreams can bring to us, is like, oh, I'm really irritated. That's really familiar.
Mm.
I feel that most of the time. I'm in my car. I'm yelling at the other drivers. Why do they suck so much? You know, why can't they? And then instead of that, you know, there's a feeling that's underneath. So what's underneath? You know, what's underneath is like fear, incredible fear. So, you know, when you feel the irritation that's very familiar in your life, you're in your car and you're yelling, or you're in line at the grocery store and you're very, want to get out fast. And you're, instead, wait, go to the place where you felt the fear.
Mm-hmm.
And that will change your life. So what's really happening? Oh, I'm really feeling fear in those moments.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not irritated. You know, really what's underneath that reaction is the fear. And then that's it. It will change your whole life, you know. And as you said, the dreams bring the images. So you don't have, you can just be with that image, you know, go right back to the dream, to that place in the dream.
Mm-hmm. Right. The perfect meditation of where you're at right now. I mean, the dreams are incredibly personalized. And, you know, that's one thing that I've been so blown away by the dreams, is that each person has a very different experience of life, and that the dreams kind of help you, the dreamer, to navigate your particular life and your particular relationship to your emotions. And we'll talk about more about relationships to other people in a little bit, too. But the dreams are very particular. And often when I'm hearing someone else tell me a dream, I feel like I'm looking through a window. Like I'm not, or maybe I'm sitting by them looking through their window. Like, what is it like for you to be you? Because it's different than it is for me to be me. And I don't assume that it's the same, you know. And just learning about other people's experience of life is really amazing part about working with dreams.
Yes, I agree so much. It's so deeply moving, you know. And just I always, particularly with the people I work with, what I want to know in my heart so deeply is, what is it like for this person to just walk in the world? What is their experience?
Right.
You know, as a human, and because, as you said, it's completely different than mine. And it's very, it means a lot, you know, to me to be let into that experience, and it's very, very helpful. And vulnerable and intimate, and as the dreams are, you know, and as the archetypes, you know, that live in the underworld, you know, that where our dreams come from, you know, and they know us more intimately than certainly any human could ever know us.
Right.
So that's why they bring with such great precision and love these particular people, these particular moments, these particular, you know, activities. Because that's going to be the thing that is like the pinprick of light that will just eventually open the whole chasm.
Right. There's a quote by Anne Lamott, which I'm going to paraphrase here, which I always loved, which is, we are always comparing our insides to other people's outsides. You know, you could see like three happy people who look happy, and they might have very different experiences of their life. You know, one might genuinely be joyful, another might be struggling to keep from crying but putting on a happy face. And you know, there's so many different ways of being in the world, and the dreams really, like you say, pierce through any kind of facade and go right to what's really happening inside, literally in our brains, as well as in our souls, and on a spiritual as well as a physiological level. The dreams really are the working out of what's going on inside, really inside, not just what we'd like to project or what we think we're feeling.
Right, or what we think we should be.
That one, yes. Yeah, that one.
Right. Uh-huh. Yeah, and that's why I was one of those people. You know, at that time when I was talking about when I was like hurting myself and anorexic, the most common thing that people said to me was, "You are the happiest person I have ever seen."
Oh my goodness! Wow.
Or, you know, and I was so not that. And that goes to show the extreme. I felt the extreme other direction, you know, that I was really, really in so much pain, like just agonizing all the time. And yet my cover, you know, my mask was this incredibly happy, enthusiastic. I mean, you know this a little bit, Catherine, because when, you know, way back when, I was, you know, it took a long time for me to really exercise, you know, that. And what a gift, what a relief to be without that.
Yeah, yes, exactly. I mean, we think we have to have this mask on. We think that we would die without it. But there's so much more freedom and so much more energy because it takes a lot of effort to maintain the happy face.
Right. It takes a lot of effort to deny our feelings. It takes an incredible amount of effort.
Right.
And it's completely exhausting. It's no wonder, you know, and I think that's part of why people right now, I notice in my son's lifetime, he's 12 right now, and in those 12 years, everything has sped up, and everyone I talk to is like working more. Everyone's doing more and working into the night. And I feel like part of that, I have great concern about that. And that way of living does not work for me. It really, it makes me very unhappy. And not fun to be around.
Well, I want to talk a lot more about relationships and about your son and how dreams help with our relationships in our families and in our lives. And I need to go to a break now and do a little station ID. So thank you, Amy. This is the Dream Journal, and you're listening to K-Squid 90.7 FM, Community Radio of Santa Cruz, and I am Catherine Bell. We are about to start our last segment, so this is your time. The number to call is 831-900-5773, so you're welcome to give us a call and share a dream or share some of your experiences or ask a question. We're all dreamers here, so no judgment, just try share a dream, see what it feels like. The number here again is 831-900-5773. That's 900 KSQD. I was gonna die. The phone lines are now open. If you'd like to call in, that number is 831-900-5773. You're welcome to share a dream or ask a question. My name is Catherine Bell, and I'm here live with Amy Trafford, Archetypal Dreamwork Therapist. So, Amy, you have a podcast called Raising a Lion in the Jungle, all about relationships and dream work. Maybe you could say a little bit about your podcast.
I do. Thanks so much for bringing it up. Yeah. Wait, my son is talking to me right now in that drawer right there.
What great timing. I love that.
I do a podcast with my son's dad. We do it on co-parenting, and it's been a few years, you know, since we've had our son, and we found that a lot of people were talking to us, a lot of parents and parents who were splitting up, and they were, like, talking to us about how it is for us, and we were just like, we should do something. You know, we should just do something. So we should have known, but we didn't know it was going to be so much about dreams and our own work, but inevitably, he and I, that's how we met, and that it's so much... For me, it's you can't really separate my dreams and my work. It is truly who I am, and that life is my blood, you know. So as my blood flows, so do my dreams and that whole energy within me. So we do talk a lot on the podcast about I hope it's really good practical information for people, and if they want to start, you know, working with their dreams in this way, or just in how working with your dreams can really help, like, manage difficult situations, but manage in, you know, in a more positive way, like, just to really take things back to ourselves and, you know, work it within ourselves, you know, and so not be as reactive, to really kind of be able to be together and be vulnerable and also know when it just discern and slow things down. You know, I know it's funny, I feel like I have a lot to say as we talk, because this is very exciting to me. This subject is my favorite subject, but also so much about the dreams and working with my dreams has been about slowing down. And that's connected to the central body piece. Like, when we slow down and go into the feelings of the dreams, all of a sudden we're awake in our bodies. Like, my body is, like, completely alive. And it feels so good. Like, it feels so good to feel every feeling and really let it be and let the energy be in my body. And so that, in order to do that, it involves needing to slow down. And when we're together and we're in a situation, and, like, Wake's dad and I are trying to, you know, work something out, he will say, you know, one of us will text, like, I'm having a reaction right now. Mm-hmm. You know, I want to talk about this, but I'm having a reaction. So, you know, I'll reach out when I'm through it. You know, so we have that language and have that knowledge, but we really do use our own dreams and our own personal work with our dreams to take back the projection and the reaction, and then we can come together in vulnerability and just as human beings, you know, and not sort of wanna, that energy of wanting to pick a fight.
Right, right.
Or... yeah.
Well, there's a rule of thumb that I've heard that, well, applies to a lot of different things, but it also applies to relationships, called the 80-20 rule, where if something is happening, it's probably 80% your situation and 20% something happening in the outer world. So
yeah,
a reaction is where some little thing, like, what is a reaction? Why don't you go ahead and define a reaction? Like, what is that? And what would you say is a reaction so that our listeners can... you know, be on the same page with us about that.
Yeah, that's a great question, actually. So a reaction is, you know, Ben would have the great brain language, Ben Newman, my cohort on the podcast, and in parenting and in life. But, you know, a reaction is an emotional reaction. So something can happen, an exchange can happen. It can also happen inside our minds, but where... so a feeling is actually open, but instead of feeling that feeling, we react, and then it comes out as something else. You know, it can come out as, you know, as anger, as blame very often, you know, anger and blame. Like, he's just this, and, oh, he never does anything, and, you know, I do everything, and, you know, whatever it is. But really, if we get underneath it, if we can, like, ease up and take it down and really breathe and take time and just open, this is speaking for me, at least, this is the best way that I can describe it. What I can often feel is like, oh, I'm scared. Like, I need help, you know? So, like, to get to what's underneath that emotional reaction place of, like, you know, anger, blame, and reactions, dreams really help with this, because reactions can look and seem really real. They certainly can feel real. It's very volatile, you know, and often there's like a negative pleasure aspect, like it feels really good. In social media, it comes up a lot. It's like people just go on Facebook, everyone is just projecting and reacting.
Yes.
And then, you know, kind of supporting each other to continue to project and react. And so really there's the reaction comes when there was a feeling that wasn't felt. And, you know, and it can be a trigger, like a trauma trigger, like, oh my gosh, like something from our childhood, like, oh, this, you know, I have a lot of dark mother stuff. Often a woman who's like, you know, in her 60s and 70s, I can have an initial like reaction to of not wanting, you know, of just not being open. It's like in that reactive place, everything shuts down. And it's like, for me, my eyes are closed tight. My hands are up in the air.
Right. So there's like a real physical response, like where you like you say, your hands closed. Like, it sounds like you're like defending yourself. Like you have your fists up almost.
Right. It's like, it's absolutely. And it's a defensive reaction. It's also... once, and again, my dreams, the only way I know this is because my dreams help me with this, but, and if we can bring more consciousness into each moment, which again, the dreams help with, the feeling of a reaction is completely different. You know, it feels to me like in my body, this is a clue for me. It's happening in my body before my mind even says I'm in reaction. It is like this very specific, spiky, staticky feeling in my body. Like the energy in my body is like barbs, you know, and it's inside. It's like, and the way it's moving is even like very aggressive. But when I'm just feeling a feeling, if I'm feeling like an anger that's like coming from the true depths of who I really am, or, you know, and it's a helpful anger that's going to move through and is essential mm-hmm. for me to feel. It's just the feeling of it is like completely open. Everything is open, and it's like a more mushy, more mushy, like a very much, very soft, you know, much, much softer feel to it. And also another clue is when I'm really feeling something, I'm not hanging on to it. You know, I have no attachment to it. The other thing with reactions is like, boy, man, those start and we just want to stay in them, you know?
Yeah.
We want to tell all our friends about it. We want to go on Facebook and tell everybody about, you know, get everyone all worked up. And that's like, but when I'm in a feeling, it just, you know, it can move through and become something else. And often there is love present.
Even if you're angry.
Yes, the love energy, you know, and pain especially. You know, there's like an incredible amount of pain, of love that is in, you know, that pain when I'm feeling it. And it's like all swirling together. So that's just like ways that I've learned, you know, through just practicing and through working with my dreams and knowing myself and being able to look at myself and be really honest and look at all this stuff that is like, you know, kind of icky, but good. Let's show me the icky stuff.
Right.
So I can move through it and I can become more of who I really am.
Right. So even all this stuff has to do with relationships, but it comes back to noticing what's happening inside ourselves.
Right. I mean, as you know, it always starts with us.
Yeah.
You know, it always starts with us.
Which is the 80-20. So there is a little 20 out there.
Yeah.
And we don't, I'm not condoning anybody to put up with any abuse or things like that. There are reasons that we might need to change a relationship. You can't just say, oh, it's all my fault. Like, they're trying to tell me that it's all my fault. We're not saying that at all. Just saying that there's a way that we can inflame relationship situations. You know, I've read, and I'm going to have to look up this source because I keep quoting this and I want to make sure I'm getting it right. But my understanding is that emotions in our body, which are like a chemical cascade in our body, they dissipate very quickly within like a couple of minutes. And that if you're still feeling angry half an hour later or 3 days later, you're stoking it up in your mind over and over again.
Yep, right.
So, you know, that's a clue that if something's going on for a long time, there's some story in your mind that's perpetuating this feeling, and that's not healthy to be in those emotions for so long.
Right, and what a beautiful thing to notice. You know, what an incredible thing, because then once we notice it's happening and we notice a pattern, and then that's when the beginning of it ending, can be. It's
right.
Like, oh, wait, you know, I'm still angry? Like, what is going on? And so often in pathology, you know, the shadow, whatever, you know, in the dream work, we in archetypal dream work, we speak of pathology, and that's, you know, these things that behaviors and patterns of behavior that are just blocking us from our souls, you know, and from blocking us from being really present in the present moment and really being open and being relational and in relationship with others. And so that anger and holding on to that anger, what a great thing, because then I'm guessing, you know, if that were the case with someone, it will come up in a dream, you know, and just like, oh, wait, oh, wow, yeah, I was angry. For 3 days I was angry. And then really, you know, what was really going on? The dreams help illuminate that,
right.
You know, what was really going on? You know,
right.
What is the thing underneath? And in feeling, in discovering and feeling that's underneath the anger, we then can stop the pattern, that pattern of anger.
So ultimately, it's hopeful and powerful, empowering.
Yes. It is so empowering. Uh-huh. Yeah.
So yeah, there's something empowering about bringing our situation back to ourselves, and with a lot of tenderness, because there can be shame, and we sometimes blame ourselves or shame ourselves, and that's just another trick actually to keep from feeling a true feeling, because true feelings are often more like fear, or well, joy is a true feeling that we're often very surprisingly resistant to feeling.
Yep, absolutely. I just a couple days ago I said to someone, you know, I am really comfortable feeling pain. And I, you know, and I said, I was like in tears, you know, bring no, like waking from a dream, like no, saying that, can you just keep me with the pain, because feeling how loved I am is so excruciating. Feeling how loved I am from the inside, you know, is so excruciating. And it sort of became, it's kind of weird, it became easier. That I do remember the dream, you know, that helped me break that. But it was hard to look at, you know, because I then had pride about how easy it was for me to feel pain.
Right. Do you feel comfortable sharing the dream that helped you with break that?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. In the dream, I was, it was like the time of Jesus. You know, you know, Mary Magdalene or whatever, and I was enshrouded, and I was walking in a desert, and I was just walking and walking and walking and walking in the desert, and I just felt absolutely, like, I felt bereft, I felt, like, so much pain and alone, you know, and I was just in the desert, and actually the dreams were asking me to not feel that. You know, to not be that. Their point was to show me that it is time for me to exit the desert. But I really did not want to do it. I was like, I didn't believe, like, the teacher at the time. I was in, you know, leadership and learning how to work with people and work with groups and their dreams. And I wasn't having it. I just wasn't ready. I was not willing to let it go. So she had me just walk in that desert. And Catherine, it took at least one full day of me for 8 hours when we were in group. She did not let me sit down. She had me just walk in that desert. And all of a sudden, I got it. I was like, this feels awful.
Right.
Like, it's awful. And, like, you know, I could just, finally, everything broke. I could feel the pride that I had in it. I could feel the terror of that I was avoiding by staying in the pain, because it was just terrifying to feel how loved I was.
Yeah, yeah.
And to feel how not alone I was, and to feel how seen I was. So deeply, you know, how deeply loved and deeply seen I was. And I wanted to just be in the, because what the pain had become was more of an, oh, woe is, you know, oh, woe is me.
Right.
I'm a victim.
Right.
You know, but look at me. I can feel.
Your independence. So, you have this this independence here. And I felt like you mentioned pride, that there's a way that we, like, I can do it myself. And that can be a really, that's a place that feels good in a way, but it can be a kind of a dead end.
Yeah. That's a hard one for people to learn, you know, that caretaking, the big thing of caretaking is that, and that's what I was thinking this morning. One of the things I woke up with was how dreams, it's really not what, the whole dream reality is kind of the opposite of the waking life reality, and things that look good in the eyes of the waking life and the world, dreams will bring, and they're actually showing us that these things, that these behaviors that we do and these ways that we are in the world that are so great and people love and seem to be, like, look on the surface to be very virtuous things, are actually getting in the way of us growing, are actually going, like, keeping our souls tamped down. You know, one of those things is taking care of other people. You know, we're like, oh yeah, I take, you know, care of this person and take care of that person, and I do all these great things, but, like, where are you in that? Where are you?
Well, Amy Trafford, how can folks get in touch with you?
You can message me on Facebook if you'd like. I'm there as Amy Trafford. You can, the best way would be to email me at amy.w.traf@gmail.com.
Okay.
And then we can set up a phone conversation, you know, if you want to just ask me questions, learn a little bit more about what I do. I mean, I also do practice of presence work with people who aren't sure they want to work with their dreams, but I do some practice of presence stuff. So if you're interested in any of that stuff, you can just email me and we can connect.
Wonderful.
And listen to the podcast. It's really fun.
Right.
Sunday's podcast with Benjamin Newman on his Facebook page.
So you do a Facebook Live, but then you record it and podcast it, is that what I understand?
Yeah. Uh-huh. So you can listen to it and look up the old ones on Apple Podcasts.
And it's called, the name again?
Raising a Lion in the Jungle.
Wonderful. So, Amy Trafford, do you have any final thoughts you'd like to share with our listeners?
I'm just feeling a lot of love for everyone and a lot of appreciation and gratitude for the dreams and for all that they, bring to us. And for you, Catherine, thank you so much. I really appreciate your presence.
You're so welcome.
And yeah.
It's great to have you on the show, Amy. Let's keep in touch.
Yeah, be awesome. Yep.
Okay, I'll take care now. Bye.
Okay, bye.
So next week on the Dream Journal, our guest will be Dr. Leslie Ellis, who will explore the difference between regular nightmares and post-traumatic nightmares. She will give examples of how typical nightmares are often powerful metaphors that can lead to transformation. And she will also talk about the more troubling traumatic nightmares and their complicated path toward wholeness. She'll offer some constructive ideas from an embodied experiential perspective about what you can do to safely engage with disturbing dream material. That's Dr. Leslie Ellis next week on the Dream Journal live Saturday at 10 a.m. or catch the podcast replay.
Sweet dreams till sunbeams find you.
I am Catherine Bell, and this has been the Dream Journal. Thanks for listening. You can find out more about my dream coaching practice at experientialdreamwork.com. I offer private sessions, dream groups, and online classes. If you have a dream you're curious about, you're welcome to contact me for a free introductory dream consultation. You can also reach me at katherine@ksquid.org. That's katherine at ksqd.org. Let me know if you have suggestions for interviews or questions about a dream. If you like this show, please leave us a review on Apple Podcasts or tell a friend how much you are enjoying the show. I'd like to thank my program assistant, Max Deaton, and our creative musician, Rick Kleffel, who created an original composition for our ambient music again today. Thank you, too, to all the generous donors who support this station. K-Squid is 100% listener-supported. Donations are always welcome at ksqd.org. Tell them that the Dream Journal sent you. That's all for the Dream Journal. Join us again next Saturday at 10. When you wake up tomorrow morning, take a minute to look within. Do you remember a dream? Write it down and bring it to the next Dream Journal.